Okay, great. Well, let us begin. Thank you all for coming to this final fall semester meeting of the Medieval History Workshop. And thanks also to our co-sponsors for this meeting, Harvard's Initiative for the Sciences of the Human Past and the Standing Committee on Archaeology, without whose generous support today's event would not have been possible. So thank you. A small note, after today's lecture, the Medieval Studies Committee is holding their holiday party in Barker 120 until 7 p.m. So you're invited to stop by and follow up Anglo-Saxon radiocarbon dating with cider and wine. Interdisciplinarity is a trait that's frequently praised but still too little practiced in the humanities. Yet anyone familiar with our speaker today, John Hines, professor of archaeology at Cardiff University, will know that Professor Hines' work embodies interdisciplinary approaches to archaeology, literature, and linguistics at their finest. How many Anglo-Saxon archaeologists would begin their books with a detailed analysis of William Carlos Williams' poetry, as Professor Hines did in his 2004 monograph, Voices in the Past? An example of Professor Hines' method can be seen in a recent article of his from 2015. Starting with a tiny runic inscription on a 5-centimeter-long piece of silver found in Lincolnshire, Professor Hines takes us to Bede by way of the Septuagint, the Vulgate, and close Anglo-Saxon philology, and ends by dating the object itself, identifying a new Old English verb form, highlighting a new variant of an Anglo-Saxon rune, and casting light on the process by which liturgical Latin was being recast into Old English in the 10th century, all in one article. Professor Hines holds a DPhil from Oxford, where he worked with Sonia Hawkes, the great expert on Anglo-Saxon Kent, among many other things. He has been at Cardiff since 1983, first as a lecturer, and then since 1997 as professor and reader of archaeology. Among his numerous awards and honors, Professor Hines was the Quiggin Memorial Lecturer for 1998 at Cambridge, and his lecture was published in 2002 as Old Norse Sources for Gaelic History. And Professor Hines was a visiting fellow at All Souls, Oxford, for 2003-2004. And so we're delighted to add the Medieval History Workshop to this list of distinguished hosts and have Professor Hines with us here today to speak on radiocarbon statistics and archaeology, building a scientific chronological framework for early Anglo-Saxon England and its implications. Please join me in welcoming Professor Hines.
Great, thank you very much. I'm just wondering if for the slides we can drop the lighting a little bit, or will that spoil it for the filming over there? You think it'll be okay?
It's good. It might make things a fraction clearer. Up there. I'm going to start by saying I'm tremendously honoured by the invitation to come here and indeed the extremely warm reception that I've enjoyed over the last 48 hours since I arrived, a rather sort of breathless journey up from Richmond, Virginia on Saturday morning. This lecture that I'm going to be giving you this evening is about chronology. It is about dating events in the past. And to fit in with the character of the lecture series, as I understand it, and not least the co-sponsorship from Science of the Human Past program, the emphasis is going to be very much on what can be done by using scientific techniques within archaeology, rather than trying to run some sort of breathless class on how you actually do it. Happy, very, very happy to talk about that, and of course you can't ever entirely separate these things out. But there's also going to be within this talk a very strong emphasis on why one should bother doing these things at all. In other words, an attempt to evaluate the outputs and the results of these various techniques and having a look at what difference they make to our understanding of the past. I'm going to be focusing on the... we have no pictures. This is not good. It's going to be a shame if the pictures don't come through and we only have the text. So I hope those can come through in some way. While we're getting this sorted out, I hope,
I will tell you that I'm going to be focusing on the early Anglo-Saxon period. And the early Anglo-Saxon period is the British facet, if you like, of what's variously called the very early Middle Ages, can be called the late Antique period, and indeed over much of Europe has been known as the migration period. That something must be there to say that. Certainly bravo for that achievement. Actually, do you know what? I actually like it when things like this happen. It really breaks the ice and you think, right, let's just get on there and give them the talk. I'm actually going to assume, I know there are people here with massive expertise in this, but I'm also assuming this is a public lecture. There'll be people who, you know, shall we say expertise in other parts of the world who would like a brief intro to where we are and what we're doing here. So this very early Middle Ages, it starts with the fall of the Roman Empire, and particularly the collapse of the Roman Empire in the West, leaving a residual but very substantial empire in the East, in Constantinople. Over an awful lot of Western Europe, power was seized. Land was seized in many cases by Germanic groups right across the empire, from Britain through Gaul in Italy and Iberia and down into North Africa as well. In the case of Britain, we're very clear that by around about the year 410 and 411, the Roman Empire had effectively declared the British provinces independent. It was a sort of unilateral declaration of independence, but in this case by the empire rejecting provinces rather than those provinces breaking off. Very simply, it was impractical and it was far too expensive for the Central Empire to continue to attempt to hold on to their British provinces. By the middle of the 5th century, we've got clear evidence, both archaeological and historical, that there is a new people and a very powerful people on the scene in southern and eastern Britain. And these are people who those sources are habitually referring to as the Saxons. It's a name that we've got in early sources. They're recognized as the Saxones. Their homeland, their heartland, at this stage at least, we can archaeologically locate in the province of Niedersachsen, maintaining that name in northern Germany. And this is just one of a series of maps that come out of this particular publication here. I'd like to point out that Peter, who is actually now a keeper at Colonial Williamsburg, was thoroughly excited when his thesis came out as volume 410 in the British Archaeological series, that being the date of the abandonment of Britain by Rome. He saw that as a very, very helpful omen indeed. Another thing that I put up on this slide is actually just something to indicate how not only have we got material that is coming across the North Sea in that way, but this particular material also illustrates very nicely how those Germanic groups of this migration period, of these very early Middle Ages, what is going on there is building on Roman foundations. The art style that they adopt as their most prominent style is derived from provincial Roman art. What Peter demonstrated here in a really fascinating way, he's got here a series of circular shield designs from a late Roman source, the Notitia Dignitatum, and he's demonstrating that one for one, they've all got extremely close counterparts in little round brooches, so-called saucer brooches, that are being worn by Saxon women. It's important, actually, in the case of Britain, to emphasize that for certain historical and archaeological reasons, it's possible for the narrative of the fall of the Roman Empire and the transition into the early Middle Ages to get a really Anglo-centric
bias and to be dominated by the story of the creation of England, as if the creation of Wales, the Kingdom of Cornwall, the power in Cumbria, the Scottish Kingdom, and so on, was just what was left over after that. This wasn't the case. These were very definitely interactive processes, and indeed the process by which there seems to have been, in a cyclical way, a counterpart to the invasion and the cultural appropriation of territory in Britain by Germanic peoples in the establishment of Brittany in the northwest of France. It's important to emphasize that when I use a term like Germanic and talk about Germanic peoples, I'm talking primarily about peoples who are defined by the dominant language that they use, but it's also a description that can be used in material cultural terms as well. Now, having said that there are Roman foundations to the early Middle Ages, it's important also not to understate the massive dislocation and disruption that there is between late Roman Britain and early Anglo-Saxon England. It's certainly true that, as here at the case of Colchester in Essex, one of the principal cities of late Roman Britain, indeed Roman Britain all the way through, it's not uncommon for us to find in the very, very latest levels of activity on those sites and datable to the 5th century, evidence of the presence of a new material culture. Here in Colchester, we've got, in a small corner of the town, we've got some distinctive building types that are of Germanic form, the so-called Grubenhaus, actually something that's adopted from even further east, from Slavonic areas in Germany, but certainly not native to Roman Britain. And within the extramural cemeteries, typically Roman extramural cemeteries of the town, we can also find just two or three women who are buried in a very Germanic style, a Germanic style represented by the dress that they're wearing, a type of dress held up by two matching shoulder brooches with quite conspicuous beads as well, and simply the fact that they are being buried in this dressed manner, and therefore those survive in the grave. This is something that is characteristic of the Germanic practices of the continent and really very alien to late Roman practices. So that does happen in those late Roman sites, but none of those sites continues. Colchester, we've got a complete break from the end of the 5th century right the way through to the early 10th century in the archaeological record. It's the same in many, many other places, and not least in those Roman villa sites, small towns, where we find this intrusive Anglo-Saxon presence at the very end. Rather, we see a series of completely new sites being established. There are new settlement sites, small villages or hamlets, we really ought to call them. And not least, there are a very, very large number of burial sites that we can find. These are easily found and identified because of the fact that they have very, very big material footprints. These are not just skeletons left in the ground that might rot away. There's the reintroduction of cremation into the burial practice in some cases, as at Spong Hill in Norfolk, in a huge cemetery of several thousand cremation graves, often in very large, very conspicuous urns of this kind, a practice that had long since gone out of use in Roman Britain. And there are the inhumation graves, the burial of the unburnt dead, buried more clothed rather than in the first instance, rather than with other artifact types. And those artifact types were very easily found just in farming, when in the 19th century they were building the railways, all sorts of work going on in the land. And they were, of course, collected in by antiquarians. Now, in one sense, chronology has always been really fundamental to the understanding and appreciation of these archaeological finds.
It's very interesting that, in fact, in the 1840s, just at the time when archaeology was moving from a gentleman's connoisseur interest in the past into becoming some sort of methodological modern scientific discipline, and big new national organisations like the British Archaeological Association were being set up. At that time, early Anglo-Saxon archaeology was absolutely dominating the archaeological agenda within Britain, not least because there was plenty of stuff out there and it was a profitable, and I mean intellectually profitable, pastime to go and dig up the sites, not least in very conspicuous burial barrows. That interest, that Enlightenment scientific interest, had actually begun in the middle of the 18th century, but from the middle of the 18th century through to the middle of the 19th century, we will often find in the publications of these finds that the material is misidentified. The great excavator in Kent in the mid-18th century, the Reverend Brian Fawcett, who's not a very pious clergyman, it has to be said, but he thought he was excavating the remains of the ancient Britons, and he wrote up his diaries in that light. Many of the finds published at this time are attributed to Danes. It's a catch-all term for the Vikings within England. It was actually in 1793 that another Kentish clergyman, the Reverend James Douglas, succeeded in identifying some of Fawcett's finds as coming from the early Middle Ages, and he did that by being able to read the inscription on a Merovingian coin in one of these graves and identifying the king on it as a 6th century king from historical sources. So basically, chronology, putting the right date to the finds, means giving those finds a historical identity. And it's in that light, albeit in a much more sophisticated, much more detailed way, that we have been continuing to look at these things. Now, in fact, chronology came to be refined. It was based very much on the typology of the artifacts, and it was looking at the type of brooch and trying to find subtle differences between very similar objects. And indeed, by the time that archaeology, together with every other discipline in the humanities, hit its transient period of theory, when theory dominated everything from the late 70s through to the later 90s. At that point, there was a real reaction to these traditional methods of archaeological research, seeing a focus and a specialization on issues like typology and chronology as being something that would really preclude more interpretative and more sophisticated interpretations of the past, rather than being something that would precede and support those interpretations. Nonetheless, work did go on, and it went on not least by doggedly stubborn or doggedly old-fashioned people such as myself. Back in the 1960s, Vera Evison started using continental chronologies a lot more to look at what was going on in southern England, and indeed my own supervisor, who's mentioned just now, Sonia Chadwick Hawkes, did much the same thing, although focusing more on the late Roman to early Anglo-Saxon transition. It's of considerable significance, in fact, that these two scholars do actually represent how it was for the first time in Anglo-Saxon chronology in that immediate post-war generation, that we had women scholars coming through and starting to lead the field. But in various ways, we kept going on this, and slowly, slowly, we started being able to use more sophisticated techniques, such as the use of computers and the like. The page that you've got here is something that is taken out of my doctoral thesis from 1983, where in fact it is done that the lettering there is actually beautifully done with the old letter set, you know, it's like a little kid's printing set. You put in every letter on time in line, trying to get it in the right place and in line. And it showed my attempts to bring together the chronologies from Scandinavia, England, and the continent, simply to give myself a framework for the study that I did then, which was looking at connections between England and Scandinavia. It was one of those classically innocent but actually very, very productive things you do as a doctoral student. I knew there were chronological schemes out there, and I assumed they were done by authorities who had got everything right. And as soon as you start to investigate how they know what they're saying, what they're doing, how they actually fit together, you suddenly find that you're becoming as much of an expert as anybody else in the world is at the time, because you can see where they're not quite matching. But an interesting thing here is if you look down under England, it says it's based on cruciform brooches by Reichstein, a German scholar, 1975, and the names of all of the phases there, apart from the Dorchester type of brooch, they're all given in German, because we didn't really have a very good Anglo-Saxon chronology at the time. We had real problems creating a chronology for early Anglo-Saxon England. For one thing, looking at those burials, we had to treat the male and female sequences separately. It's not the case that there isn't some common material between male and female burial practices, but it's not the sort of stuff that helps us at all. Things like the little practical knives that both men and women, and indeed many children, wore at the belt, nobody has ever yet found any real chronological development in those. So immediately our material is split, whereas on the continent in Scandinavia, they will create common chronologies. It's also the case that, unlike the well-behaved and very methodical Germans, in Anglo-Saxon England, we have massive regional difference. There does seem to be a huge amount of inconsistency and diversity in our material. And so for a large degree, we were creating small, local, specialized chronologies and trying to fit those all together. As in this case, just saying there's one fairly common type of brooch, and that's going to have to be the basis of our chronology going on through. Developments that came in included ways of tracing gradual variation in the artifact inventories. This is from a French publication that's gone through several editions so far, and there's a charming essay early on in this discussing the virtues of the difference between the so-called permutation manuelle and the permutation machinelle, between doing it by hand and doing it using a machine. And they've gone over the computers too. By the 1990s, there was a new move afoot within chronological studies, and a group of us from Britain, from Germany, and Scandinavia and France held a couple of major seminars, one in Aalborg in Denmark and then one in Strasbourg at the late 1990s. And out of that, although not only out of that, came a project which was funded by English Heritage and which is the basis of the new chronology that we've got for early Anglo-Saxon England. This was very much designed from the experience of two of the principal authors and principal contributors to the report, Alex Baylis, that's Alexandra Baylis, and Christopher Skull of English Heritage, but all of us is a big collaborative project to which all of us could bring some distinct specialization, although in fact in most cases we would overlap with somebody else, so none of us were absolutely entirely on our own, or at least not for very much. It had to be worked together. The objectives of this particular project are put out there. They do include trying to get things better within England, but they were also explicitly included the attempt to make the methodological know-how and skill set and indeed the availability of equipment to do some of these things much more widely available and widely used, and to give people the opportunity to appreciate and to know how to do these things. So what we were doing there should be applicable outside of this. Decision was taken to focus on the period 570 to 720. This was based on a couple of prior understandings, in other words, things we thought we knew, which were not entirely wrong, though we've proved them largely wrong since there, and also in terms of the best available techniques we had. We could already see that there was some sort of big shift in the furnished burial practices of early Anglo-Saxon England, which very roughly we could say took place sometime in the final third of the 6th century, shall we say somewhere between the mid-560s and 600. In fact, divided opinion tended to go to either end of that. Either you thought it was early or you thought it was late. And this was still a very, very live debate when we set this project up. And it's also important to remember, we set this up 20 years ago, even though we only actually got round to reporting in 2013. It took an awful lot of work. It was also thought that by around about 720, the traditional practice of furnished burial had ended. This was long after the conversion of England to Christianity. It seemed as though there was no real correlation between conversion and what the burial practice was. It simply became more and more anachronistic to place grave goods in the grave. And this may have been because there was a desire at the point of death to endow the church, to give gifts to the church in order to achieve salvation as best one could in that way. But for various reasons, those were the outer parameters that we thought we could focus on. And this was not least because we were using a process of radiocarbon dating. And radiocarbon dating is effective in certain periods and very ineffective in other periods. It depends on a thing called the calibration curve. It's not a calibration curve, it's a calibration wiggle or a calibration zigzag, which you see going down there. And basically, when you get nice things like that, and you get these sharp, steady drops in the calibration curve, then you can use radiocarbon dating very well. When you get something like this here, a so-called plateau, then radiocarbon dating becomes hopeless, and I'll be illustrating this for you very clearly. I can think why we didn't go back. In fact, in terms of the drop, we could have gone back to around about 540 or even 530 in where we were focusing on. But at that time, we'd have understood that of being an area where things were hopelessly regional and our other processes just wouldn't work. So in fact, that was the cutoff point that we went for there. The processes that we were using methodologically in this project it's an iterative series, which is represented in the image that you've got in the left that you're looking here. And it runs from the very old and traditional typology, which I've mentioned already, through seriation, which is the putting things in order, as we saw briefly on that French book cover just now, through to radiocarbon dating, been around since the 1950s, but we were now able to do what we call high precision radiocarbon dating, which improves the sharpness considerably, and then down to something called Bayesian modeling, which I'll be illustrating for you a little bit from here onwards. just to show you very briefly what sort of things we were doing here. This is actually precisely the sort of thing that would have been done any time from the middle of the 19th century onwards. That's trying to find the most effective way of dividing up a certain group of objects. These are objects that are always very, very easily recognized, the bosses of shields. It's actually quite charming going back to the Reverend Brian Fawcett's diaries from the 18th century, and not least because he thought he was dealing with the ancient Britons. He chose to use Latin terms for everything that he's finding. So he would never talk about shield bosses. These were umbones, and so on. And there's a particularly nice thing when he's talking about the brooches that women are wearing. He refers to these, each brooch is a fibula subnectens. Now, I actually looked this up. Fibula, well, that's common enough for a brooch or a fastener. Subnectens is a word that occurs once only in classical Latin. It occurs once in Virgil's Aeneid, and it's used to describe Dido wandering around looking absolutely gorgeous, wearing a particular brooch, and the word subnectens is used of this gold brooch that's holding her gown together to say it's fastened on the back, the fastening is hidden away, all you see is the beauty of the artistry of the front of that brooch. It really illustrates beautifully how Fawcett is bringing that enlightenment education of a gentleman to archaeology, and yet this term has survived all the way through there. We're using it all the time. Now, the typology was very much done by my Danish colleague, Karen Højlund Nielsen, who's worked a great deal with Chris as well, and she did an absolutely superb job in sorting out some very, very difficult material. Just very briefly here on the shield bosses, we could find a good series between types that have got this concave wall there, as well as a concave cone. Types here, much straighter wall and a concave cone, and often a big spike there. Here, the cone is getting straight, or it's even turning slightly convex in that way. Colossal difference between these in terms of the width of the flange. It's very subtle, but it matters a huge amount, and the shape of the rivets that are holding it onto the shield board, and then later on you get these very tall ones. It's proved a brilliant typology to use. We can now get not only all the shield bosses in Anglo-Saxon England into types, but we can also date them very nicely too. Sorry, the wrong one there. Okay, seriation. I'm not going to try and describe the maths of correspondence analysis for you. It is a way. It is a form of matrix analysis based on matrix algebra. In other words, it looks at data that are put into a matrix. Let's imagine we've got one grave. It's got types A, B, and C in it. The next grave, historically, comes at a time when type A has become obsolete and it's replaced by type B. So the next grave in the sequence, theoretically, will be B, C, D, then C, D, E, D, E, F, and so on. You could have a perfectly smooth matrix seeing the presence of those types of that kind. And if you do have a perfectly smooth matrix under correspondence analysis, you will get a perfect parabola appearing in a 2D plot that is taken out of multi-dimensional coordinate space. And these are the plots that we got for the male burials using our types, looking at the variation of objects within graves. And let me assure you, this is really about as good a series as you're ever going to see in this when you're dealing with real life data that are never going to be as well behaved as those other things. We looked at this material and we don't think there's going to be ever a perfect sequence. This is a, if you like, a modelled sequence of change. So we don't think every grave in this sequence. This incidentally shows the graves in that sequence there, and then you can look at the artifact types where they appear in the sequence like that. We don't think it's going to go just from early round to late going around that way.
But we do think there's going to be an early area there, then a slightly later area. We're looking for phases within this. And we found in the male sequence, we could divide the whole series up in two different ways. One is just by looking at where the graves fall and finding what seemed to be natural breaks within that, and saying, okay, that's phase A, that's phase B, C, D, and E. Or we could identify when certain types come in, and those arrows are picking up where we get particular changes in the type of shield boss that is dominant. And in fact, very roughly, those are falling in the middle of the phases that we're defining in the other way. We've got two so-called partitions of the male sequence going on there. There should have been one on radio. Let's just see what comes out. No, sorry. Somehow I've not got quite the... I'm going to show you shortly something on radiocarbon dating. I think we're working on just a slightly old-fashioned version of this PowerPoint, but it's not going to matter. Once we had divided that material up into those phases, and here are the two different phase sequences we've got, we can then take radiocarbon types, radiocarbon dates on the graves, and what we can then do is put them into one of these Bayesian models that says we think all of the graves in this phase are earlier than all of the graves in this phase, and they're earlier than all in that phase, and so on, and up to that one. And basically what these models show us is that as far as the male burials are concerned, that hypothesis, well, it can't quite say it's true. It can say it's statistically true. It can say it stands up. It passes all the mathematical tests that you put in it. And then what it also very nicely done, it says, and if that is true, then the true date of these individual burials and the true date of the boundaries, those can be recalculated and they become much, much narrower in terms. I'll show you this in tabular form shortly, so you'll be able to see it there. I just want you at this point to look at what a really, really well-behaved sequence looks like in a Bayesian model, because shortly you're going to see a really, really not very well behaved sequence. And the not very well behaved one is the women. It's the female graves. There's a sort of parabola going through here. Again, it's not a bad parabola, it's a lot better than a lot of parabolas you see published, but this sort of scythe-like shape, this rather right angular pattern, is something that tells you you've got some sort of problem in there. Basically, it comes out of that. We've got a sequence going around there, certainly, but in terms of the maths of what we're dealing with, in terms of these so-called eigenvectors, which represent nothing other than variability within the mathematical matrix, in this area, we've got a lot of variation along that particular axis and not very much that way, whereas in this area we've got the variation is on a different axis, so we may be looking at inconsistent variation here. In fact, we are not. This is the model that comes out of it, but you can see rather than that smooth line through there, there's a nasty period here. There's a period where things are really quite poorly defined in the middle of it there, and I'll be explaining how that has come up for you very shortly. This is the slide that I thought was going to come up a little bit earlier, and this is showing you a little bit more about what radiocarbon dating actually is. Radiocarbon dating is based, first of all, on a radiocarbon age of an organic sample. Very simply, as long as anything organic is living, it has got to be respiring, it has got to be breathing in some way, so it will be taking in atmospheric carbon. As soon as it dies, it stops taking in atmospheric carbon, and one particular isotope in that carbon, the carbon-14 isotope, will start to decay, and it will start to decay on a regular basis according to the half-life of the carbon-14 atom. Therefore, in theory, if you can measure how much carbon-14 is left in something and compare it with the other carbon isotopes there, you will see how much carbon-14 has been lost, and you can calculate how long it's been since that organism died. One of the complications there is within this is that the level of atmospheric carbon-14 has not been constant, and that is what is represented here by the so-called calibration curve, showing changes, even points in which it turns back on itself, let alone just turning level, like there. So that having got the radiocarbon age of something, by about 1980, it was realized that it had to be bounced off the calibration curve to create a much less regular distribution of probability of the actual date of the death of that object, and that is what we call the radiocarbon date. Now, this is quite nice. This is from a site at RAF Lake and Heath I'll be talking about shortly, where we had a man and a horse buried together. The radiocarbon dates on the two different individuals there are statistically consistent, so we can combine those to say this has got a radiocarbon age of 1626 years BP, means before 1950, plus or minus 15, which in fact, if we took it uncalibrated, would tell us that this ought to have been the first half of the 4th century. It isn't. It's got to be 150 years later than that. Interestingly, when we calibrate it, it's still telling us that it thinks most of the probability is in the first half of the 5th century, which we don't really believe, but it's finding there, because of this plateau here, about 15% of probability out there in the late 5th and early 6th century, and that, for various practical reasons, is where what we think the true date of this sample is. Now, 1 in 6 chance already from the statistics that we've got there, that's not bad. Sorry, 1 in 7 chance, really. That's not bad, but it does seem to be an example of that. We can also use radiocarbon dates and with the Bayesian model to narrow down the dates of things when we've got relationships between them that are real or hypothesized. It's a very nice example here from a site called Melbourne near Cambridge, where we had a sort of multi-stacker, multiple grave, where we couldn't be sure whether all of these burials had gone in there very close to one another, could easily have gone in a couple of years apart. What we found in this case is there's an adult and child who are almost certainly buried together sometime in the late 6th century, but then that same grave, the same plot, these are absolutely bang on top of one another, close to the middle of the 7th century, was opened up for another burial to go in, and then probably a generation after that, another burial went in after that. So there's a multiple burial, but spread out over a considerable amount of time. And you can see here, this is in fact exactly the same calibration curve as that. It's simply been shown as a mirror image of it. Mathematically, it will work out exactly the same. So from our Anglo-Saxon project, these were the results that we got. In the end, we could pull them down in this way. In fact, what we're producing dates of, or estimates of dates of here, is where the boundaries lie between the particular phases. We've got two different partitions of the male series. They look very similar, they are very similar, but nonetheless there are some interesting differences between them. We've got a single partition of the female series, reduced into only 4 phases rather than 5 phases because of the problems that we've got there. And here is this horribly messy thing in the middle there where we're struggling to define a particular boundary between the phases. If we put these into other forms, or if we start putting these into forms that we can interpret a little bit more, they show us straight away. We can take either of these, the two male ones are at the top here. They show us a very, very striking difference indeed between the male and the female sequences in practices in furnished burial. You see how that top seems almost cut off there? That's because it is. That could go up, just like the male one does there for frequency. It's just we didn't sample as much as we could of them and as much as we did in the male series. There is a very, very sharp drop in the frequency of furnished burial in the male series around about the middle of the 6th century, and then it continues to really go down until it comes to an end. We've got the same drop in the female series. In fact, it drops even lower in the female series, but then remarkably in the middle of the 7th century we've got a huge increase again in the number of women we can identify who were buried in sufficiently rich graves with artifacts that we can pick them out. If we put the two of them together, we get a form like that. This is showing the overall range of furnished burial. There's some big drop around the third quarter of the 6th century. How much higher it goes up there, we don't know at the moment because we haven't fully sampled it. But really all of this return in the frequency of furnished burial in the middle of the 7th century is down to women's graves. Now, an important thing that comes out of this is that at the very end of this sequence, both the male and the female series seem to come to an extremely abrupt end. This is putting together from a whole series of different mathematical models. And I do want to emphasize the point here. We're talking here about mathematical models of the past. We can have a lot of different mathematical models. They're all valid. They may give us different results, but those results are consistent with each other in some way. The end of furnished burial, however we do it, however we play around the data, it's coming back to estimates that may vary a little bit in spread, may vary a little bit in the range of probability, but the median value is always really, really consistent, and it's bringing us in around about the year 670, maybe one or two years before that, but nothing more than that. Interestingly, the more data you put in, the less the spread of probability, the slightly earlier you go in all of this, and that I think is also something that's going on very real. What I also want to introduce for this talk, though, is the fact that we've, since that project was completed and most of the analysis was completed in the end of the last decade, we've got a lot of new information from a site at RAF Lake and Heath at Ereswell in Suffolk. This is work that I'm doing in collaboration with the Suffolk Archaeology, and it's funded by Ministry of Defence Estates. That's where the site is. It's a very, very interesting site. It's right on the edge of the fens. The name Lake and Heath itself actually goes back to an old English. The heath element is not the sandy heathland that you might think there, but it's the word hive. It's a word for a port, a landing place from the sea. We've got settlement around a large spring here. The spring is probably remembered in the name Ereswell there. And then we've got a series of three discrete but very closely located burial sites. We've got various numbers for them there, close to the south of that spring. And then, very interestingly, about 300 yards further south, we've got another burial site that follows on just after those. That's not just interesting, that's actually scientifically actually absolutely crucial in this case. We've been able to do a lot of additional radiocarbon dating from RAF Lake and Heath. We've got about 50 more high precision dates from this site, and the work we're doing there, on the one hand, allows us to look very, very carefully at how we can correlate a national chronological framework with a regionally appropriate chronological framework and a site-specific chronological framework, where interestingly you find in some cases the key discrimination can come in at any level all of that. But we've also got some very valuable extra data here, not least because we've deliberately targeted much earlier dates. Remember, I was telling you we couldn't tell you how much there was earlier on. Well, here we've deliberately targeted the earlier area, but you can see how the spread of probability we're getting here is getting very, very smudgy because we've gone back into that plateau area on the radiocarbon curve. But here, very nicely at Eriswell, this is a female sequence going through to something that's ending somewhere between 660 and the early 680s. In other words, median value is about 670. We've reproduced that result there. But here, we're not seeing that break effect. We've got a nice, smooth continuity of female burial here. And this is somewhere, this site has given us something we just couldn't find even in the whole national sample there. This is the model that I get when I put all the male and females together and I put in that later site that we've got down there, because this is the mathematical model that doesn't quite prove for a fact that that later site starts just when the earlier site goes out of use. It proves that mathematically it may very well do, and there's even a certain degree of probability that I can quote you on that, but it certainly shows that, if you like, if they did overlap, they didn't overlap by very much, and that indeed the period of overlap, if it's anywhere, is going to be somewhere in the period around about 655 to 675. So we're homing in very, very closely here on a major change, a major break in the traditional burial practice of the Anglo-Saxon people. So trying to start talking now about the implications here, and not least about the fact that we seem to have this very, very sharp end on the practice of furnished burial. We had to look at this implications against other sequences, other aspects of the material cultural record. And immediately we ran into one thing that we're going to call, it's the numismatic problem that we are having to deal with. Because our very, very last furnished female graves, not male graves, they never turn up with men, but the very, very last furnished female graves, some of them contain coins like this grave here at Harford Farm, just outside Norwich. These the coins can take a variety of forms. They may be really quite good gold coins, which are very often worn, looped, they're worn as jewellery, like this case, a very identifiable coin. It's a coin we can date. It's issued under the Merovingian King Dagobert, reigning between 629 and 639, and this is in a grave in Suffolk. There is a series of very, very pale gold, only 15% gold, the rest of it silver, coins that we refer to as shillings, and quite rightly we refer to them as shillings, and then there are purely silver coins. I say purely silver coins, let's say no gold, mostly silver, bit of copper and so on in them too, very much of the same form in the and the same size and weight in the early form, and these are coins that are known as shatters. Shatters have various historical series, but the very earliest shatters of the primary series, like these here, turn up in these late furnished graves. Now our problem is that there is a conventional numismatic opinion that says those shatters don't come into existence until the 680s at the earliest, and any burial that contains them really should be about AD 690, AD 700. And this is one of the reasons why we thought burial was continuing into the 8th century. What our scientific dating would imply is that in fact that numismatic chronology is putting the wrong date on those coins, and we would in fact pull them back preferentially to the 660s. We can make a case for getting them into the 670s. That would just about fit with the maths, and there are scientific little twiddles we can do with things that might allow us to add 6 or 7 years onto our estimates, who get us a little bit closer. But we have to admit we have a problem. New conventional numismatics, and it's not conventional archaeology, but archaeological science. And the maths of that are giving slightly different results. Now, I have to say, when we started this project, and we said at the end of it, you're only going to be 20 years out from the numismatists, we would consider this an absolutely wonderful vindication of everything that we were doing. As it is, however, we've now defined another problem, and we've got to resolve it. I will say that there are some numismatists who are happy to accept that earlier dating, which, interestingly, would put England very, very much in parallel with Merovingian Gaul in changes of coinage. One of the planks in the conventional numismatic argument, which I'm simplifying a bit to call it that, is that the change had to take place in France first and then be transmitted to England sometime after that. It really doesn't look quite like that. We felt that with this seeing this really abrupt change in burial practice and being able to date it very closely, we believe that we really did need to go back to an old argument, an old hypothesis, and that is the idea that there is some significant influence in terms of the conversion of the English and the consolidation of the place of the church in Anglo-Saxon England that was affecting burial practice. Now, this is, I do want to emphasize that if I'm talking about the where we argue that it may have been the imposition, the final imposition of a preferred Christian burial practice through the removal of burial practices of which the church did not particularly approve, I'm talking about something that's at the end of the process of change in burial practice, certainly not one explanation that explains the beginning of the change in burial practice or explains the whole of it. People could give up furnished burial without converting to Christianity. There's absolutely no question of that. It happens in Scandinavia. The areas of England that were told historically converted to Christianity, last of all, the Isle of Wight and Sussex, had given up furnished burial from what we can see 50 years at least before they were converted to Christianity. Within furnished burial, we see lots of very clear forms of Christian representation, the inclusion of crosses. It's a bit sneaky to use Cuthbert's cross, but it's a lovely picture to put in. The Christian church did have its own ideas about burial. The period that we're looking at, we've got the Synod of Whitby in AD 664 deciding on common allegiance for the church within England. We've got Theodore arriving as Archbishop of Canterbury in AD 669 and remembered as the man who enforced common discipline and practices across the English church. The only problem we've actually got now is that some of our changes seem to be just a little bit too early for Theodore to have had anything to have done with them. So I suspect he arrived just in time to take the credit for things that were happening. We've all done that at some stage in our lives, I'm sure. So we have wanted to put back in the agenda that the final change that we see in burial practice is part of a consolidation of the church. But we would emphasize too that all the way through we can see social factors, hierarchization and so on, if affecting burial practice. We can also see economic factors coming into it too, quite simply a more differential aspect, access to wealth and a shift towards more exotic imported items being displayed in the grave rather than locally made things. It's very striking indeed that if we compare for the concluding phases of we got here, the distribution of the male graves that we've got here and the distribution of the female graves that we've got here, the male graves are very, very strongly focused around the coast, and indeed they're focused in our early port sites, Southampton, Dover, Broadstairs and Ipswich there. We have got a couple actually from London as well. But in fact, the difference between male and female seems to be even more exaggerated than we saw it before, because it's very likely that a lot of those burying here at this time are actually foreigners, Frisians, Frankish, and so on, rather than native English. They're merchant communities behaving differently. The one site, fascinatingly, that really stands out is this site here, Lechlade, right up the Thames, but in fact it's as far up the Thames as the Thames is still navigable, and the element laid in the name, it's a loading place, it is a sort of transshipment site, but I think there's a lot of study to be done in that area of Gloucestershire there. I want just to whip through a couple of things to end off here, just to show some of the rather more interesting applications of all of this. We have actually, and this is work that's only been concluded about 2 or 3 weeks ago, managed to complete the models where I have now added the RAF Lake and Heath data into the national framework. Some of these mathematical models take 6 weeks to run. Okay, it's a slow process. We melted a computer doing one at one time, which we were rather proud of, rather good at doing that. It's made interesting changes. It's sharpened up things a little bit at the beginning over here. So in fact, we'd actually be moving that slope there, would just be moving back a little bit to a peak that's back there around about 540 maybe, rather than closer to 550. We've also in fact picked up a very nice thing where we can see a subphase in East Anglia. We're picking up a regional transitional phase that we couldn't see within the whole national sequence. And the phases there are actually defined very, very much on the basis of glass bead types being worn very profusely by women. This is up the top here. This comes from the work of Beata Brugman. You can see a number of phases she's put on these various glass bead types. And there's a pretty big change between the group that we've got back here and the group that we've got down there. And that is the change that's taken place. That sort of that column there, if you like, is in this transitional point that we've got coming in towards the middle of the 5th century. Some lovely work has been done by a PhD student of mine, James, myself and Ian Freestone in Cardiff, James Peake, looking at the glass types that are being used within these beads. And he could pick up a subtle difference between two different types of glass represented by these correspondence lines that are running in there between those two different types there. They join. It's fundamentally, this is glass which is, they're using the same types of fresh glass. It's being made in the Near East. It's being produced very likely in Palestine, just could be within Egypt. It's being exported across the continent. It's coming in small bricks to France, to Germany, up into England as well. And in this group, they're using that glass as it comes to it. They're adding in colorants, which they can control. They're not changing glass. This group, however, they're mixing in wood ash into that glass and making a different glass. And what we find is that the difference between that glass, the so-called Saxon II glass, this represented by this dark blue types here, together with a form that's traditionally known as Levantine I. It's a misleading thing, but never mind about that. That glass is dominating from this period of change onwards, whereas prior to that, we've got the fresh glass used in a small number of beads, and we've also got a lot of recycled Roman glass. They're simply mining Roman sites, picking up the glass vessels from them and melting them down to form beads. So what we see with this is there is some real change in production going on around this particular transitional point. It's a change of production that seems a smaller range of objects being produced. They're being produced in a different way, and in some cases, the definitive artifact types that are coming out are much more exclusive. Whoops, sorry, like this sword here from Sutton Hoo Mine 17. It's not very, very conspicuous, but the particular type of pommel it's got on, a little square pyramidal stud that it's got there, and these very rare binding steeps. We've only got about half a dozen examples of these. Like Broomfield, they come up in the really, really big princely graves. We've got a social change in economics of production and distribution of material coming in here. And it does look as if there should be some sort of correspondence with this. I know this is going to be a very sort of simple and an old-fashioned image compared to the sophisticated ones that are available here. But the massive climatic event that we've got between 536 and 540, the climatic disaster that's showing in the drop in the growth rings of the trees there. We can also match this now the growth of sphagnum moss in English, British, I should say, and actually these are all English that I'm using here, peat bogs, where there's a cold period comes in, the sphagnum moss starts growing, you see a very clear recurrent surface in the peat bog, and while the radiocarbon dates from that are very poor and very imprecise, the interesting thing is they're consistent and that they're focusing in very, very close to this period of the climatic shift for that particular change. Now, just as with the conversion, I'm not by any means arguing that the climatic event is, if you like, the cause and the explanation of everything. What I'm saying is it's a big factor that has got to be taken into account, and I think we've got very, very good reasons for supposing specifically at RAF Lake and Heath that it's following on from this. We see a colossal drop in population. However, just as in the 14th century, a colossal drop in population is a colossally big opportunity for a lot of those who have survived, and that the change in social organization and the growth of wealth, the change in production we get there, it seems very likely to be coordinated with that in some way. I wanted to end off just with a couple of sort of very, very nice ones. There's sort of almost not part of the talk, but it's nice that we can date them closely. This is a couple of the guys we've got buried at RAF Lake and Heath, some of the really curious things we've got here. This is a man who was buried around about the year 500. We were a bit worried about the shield boss he had, so we dated this one very, very closely. He comes around about 500. If you see, that's the boss of his shield there. Just look at the way that left arm is bent round. He's been buried as if he's holding that shield in the defensive position right in front of him. What's even more interesting about him, we've got these little objects here along his legs. They're not these objects here. They're objects we wouldn't have been able to identify otherwise. But from the big Danish weapon hoards, we've got these little collections, little purse collections of pins and thorns, which seem to be suture pins. It could even have been used in acupuncture or something like that. Those armies had medics with them. They had trained people, specialists, in trying to sort out battlefield wounds. Here we seem to have a man who's had some sort of procedures done to his legs. They may not have helped him in that he ended up there with the pins still in place, but we've never seen this before, and it's something very nice. This chap here, buried crouched, he's got his arm bent up like that. But he hasn't got a shield boss there. He's not holding a shield there. He's got a spear over behind him there. What he has, however, got, he's one of the three men in the burial in the cemetery who was buried with a musical instrument. There's the remains of a lyre in this area here. He's even got a spare set of strings down there, so should he break a string, he can put a new set on like that. And it really does look here, with that bent up like that, and then the lyre is just down there in front of him. He's practically been put in the grave there as if he's actually playing the musical instrument there. And we've not actually seen this dramatic representation of life in the graves before now. Three graves with lyres, we can date them all. These three men could be three or four generations. They're spread well over from the beginning of the 6th century through to the end of the 6th century. So we'll be coming out with this stuff from RAF Lakenheath over the next 18 months or so. The big dating material and the cemetery report should appear separately from that. I know I've been talking for at least an hour now, with the, even with the break, so it's time to stop and have a few questions, but thank you for your patience in listening to us. Yeah, there's a major recurrent surface there. This has been identified since the 1950s, and
so it's the lighter streak there.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, or it's above the lighter streak.
Above the lighter.
Yeah, above the lighter streak. It's been identified since the 1950s, and the radiocarbon dates were taken in the 1950s, which is why the ones that we've got down there, they've got very, very early numbers on them, lab numbers on most of them, and they've also got colossally imprecise, one sigma ranges up to 150 years in one case, which is pretty hopeless, and we should do more of this.
And what exactly are we seeing?
Even in the late 1990s, it was argued, because they were being treated uncalibrated, that these represented a climatic disaster at the end of the Roman period, which caused the Romans to leave. In fact, I mean, I've not shown all the models that you can do of these. I've put in actually a very simple median of the figures there. Under Bayesian modelling, all of those dates could be dating exactly the same event. In other words, they are statistically consistent with one another. If they are statistically consistent with one another, they still actually leave a very broad period in which this event could have taken place, roughly from the early 5th century through to the late 6th century is when it could have taken place. The median value, however, is close to 530. You know, we're homing in there on that 536 event. Now, in fact, I would use this just to illustrate the potential and the interest of this scientific resource. What we need to do is to set up a scientific project to go back into these bogs to collect the samples. Taking one radiocarbon date on its own is useless, but with 20 really precise radiocarbon dates, and we could get these down to plus or minus, I think on the sort of things we're doing here, I would guess plus or minus 20, 25, something like that. But then if you put all of those dates together into a Bayesian model, you will get a very, very clear estimate of it. You can even ask the model, what is the probability of this being before or after AD 536? Now, there's no reason why the AD 536 event should in itself have kicked off a cold period, although there are certainly some people who would argue that it could have done. But again, even if it just coincided with a big climatic downturn, it's going to be very serious.
And what is the nature of the physical event that produces the light and dark?
It is a shift to sufficiently cold and wet conditions on a general basis that will cause the sphagnum moss to grow.
I see.
And to grow at the level in which it's creating
so
peat.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Our videographer wants us to pass around the microphone.
Oh, so sorry.
No,
I'll do that. Okay, I'll do that. Yeah.
Yes. 540s. And yeah. So when we see
rapid change in burial practices.
Yes.
It looks like it's around 550. I mean, are there other changes in burial practices beyond no more grave goods? Or
It's something that I think now with RAF Lake and Heath, we're going to say is probably, we're at the point where we're going to be able to see it varying regionally a bit more than it is. Now, admittedly, under the national project, we were looking for a national framework, you know, so we really didn't, you know, we didn't want to follow regional variation. But having done that, the next big challenge is precisely to follow that regional variation. So I'm quite sure we are going to see it. I'm sorry, I forgot to answer, to repeat the question. So are we going to be seeing variations in burial practice as a result of the plague? Well, you know, up until very, very recently indeed, what we would have said of the 6th century, we would have said it's not a problem, it's all very smooth. 5th century is a big problem because we just can't really find very much. 7th century is a big problem because we can't get a handle on the chronology. Now we say 5th century, we're getting much better handle on that, we're finding more material. 7th century, we've really sorted out, so we're making the 6th century a problem now. One of the surprising things up until very recently is we would said, although we know that what happened around 536 must have had a big impact on the people, it's inconceivable that Anglo-Saxon England would have been exempt from a plague that we've got recorded in the Welsh and Irish annals, for instance, as striking, you know, coming over from the continent, ultimately from Constantinople. And yet we'd have said, we cannot find any sign of this in the archaeological record. It's true we can look at the osteology of the skeletons. We can see that people have gone through times of hunger and shortage in their childhood and adolescent lives when they're really going to leave the mark on the growth strings. But everyone's going through that all the time. That's what it's like when you're on a subsistence level economy. Every 5 to 10 years, you're going to have a bad year, you know, and you survive it, but it leaves its mark on you. I do think that now we're beginning to see real changes taking place in the 6th century, and that what we had previously seen as a big change that might be as early as the 560s, we'd now say, yeah, that what we were looking at then definitely is the 560s, but even that too is not actually the change. That's the end of the change. The change itself is spread out over something like 30, 40 years. And it is possible, well, I'd have to say there are a few more mathematical hints now that the start should be somewhere in the 520s, I have to say, late 520s rather than mid 530s. But it's somewhere around then. And I think we have to have a model that's going to correlate those things. But if you're talking about, you know, we're not finding big mass burials, we're not finding plague pits, I would say I'm pretty confident now that we've got a much, much lower population burying at RAF Lake and Heath after sometime in the 540s than before then. And it is perfectly possible that we've actually got the population of this area of Britain has just fallen steadily from the late Roman period, goes over a cliff in the middle of the 6th century and then remains low until it starts growing again in the 7th century. I think that is a very, very valid hypothesis now to put out there, but it's a hypothesis, as all hypotheses, that's out there for testing and for refining. But it's a good basis for further scientific work, certainly. Chris.
Yeah. Chris Lovelock, Associate Professor of History at Harvard. John, it's very rare to have a project which has a whole series of fundamental impacts, not just on England, but on Europe really as well. Can I just draw attention to you and ask a question about three principal findings? The first is the numismatic problem.
Yeah.
Obviously, it brings England and Francia into line.
Yeah.
Are there any hints as to what's happening to that early Frisian series as well? Series D, series E?
It's the first question is whether the early Frisian series of shatters are moving or would move with the dating that the new dating that we would be proposing for the primary English shatters. There is just a hint, yes, but it is only just a hint. And it may be the case that because these are Frisian shatters, they actually are creeping into England and being deposited just slightly later than the English primary series shatters. So we are not getting Frisian primary shatters occurring in the same graves as these. I've certainly seen it very recently argued in relation to Dorestad that there's a much earlier context for a Frisian early shatter than we had before. So I think there could be, but I don't think the answer is going to come from the Anglo-Saxon data. It has been said we have got a few more graves with shatters in. There are later graves with shatters, but only with shatters in purse groups. I've got a nice collection from Bridge in Kent, which is undergoing study in Cardiff at the moment. It's our visiting Professor Chris Scull, who's part of this project, who's brought those over there. And I'm quite certain that the results of all of that will be that we will go on, get high precision dates on those, and be able to look at those. And so these will, if I remember correctly, there are D shatters within those collections. So, you know, we have D shatters, but they're not just going in with the A and B shatters by any means.
If I may explain what's going on here for those who aren't deeply immersed in early medieval numismatics, there is a titanic change that happens in the European monetary system.
Wait, hang on there, Mike, hang on.
That what Professor Hines is talking about is a titanic change in the European monetary system from a gold-based system to a silver-based system. This has been seen by economic historians going back to Pyrenne and before him as a fundamental transformation of the Western European economy. And the most recent conventional wisdom by very outstanding numismatists in France have argued, and it is believed by everyone up until today, that it was in France that the shift to silver began in the 670s, 680s, if memory serves, and that the English and Frisians followed suit. This has been connected with very important archaeological discoveries in the early medieval mine of Mel. This dating now raises the question of whether the shift to silver didn't actually start a decade or two earlier and did not start in France, but started outside of France, which would have very, very important implications for how we understand the beginnings of the reconfiguration of the European economy. So what Professor Hines has been presenting here is extremely important if you're interested in economic history and the big picture of the European development.
And also my second question was really the implications for the end of furnished burial in relation to, you've brought it back to 670 in England, and you see a distinct role for the church there. And yet on the continent, you do have 7th century furnished burials in churches, in monastics at the same time. So it's a highly regional, so you see a similar process or a highly regional process in terms of the attitude of the church to furnished burial in this era?
Yeah.
Yes, the case that the approach of the attitude of the church towards furnished burial is regionally varied is, it doesn't have to be made. It's clear. It is like that. I think we perhaps should emphasise what's interesting about England in this respect, that England has a unified church. You know, that this is a very definitely a decision from the Synod of Whitby. There is a decision that there is a primacy of Canterbury there too. And coming out of the seriousness of the division between the Gaelic-inspired Iona-centred churches and the Rome-facing churches and the desire for unity out of that. I think that was probably a process that was actually really quite different from anything that was even needed on the continent. So in this case, once again, you've got specifically insular conditions that are actually pushing England to take a step that
is at least at the as early as that step is taken anywhere else. The dating of the shift in the coin, I guess sort of autour de l'année is the term that Latour uses for this around the year 670, which in idiomatic French you can interpret an awful lot of ways. So it's it seems to be coming in early, but we if our scientific dating is right, we can't be any later than that. And I would say with a separate study has, I think, demonstrated that Anglo-Saxon England, certainly Kent, was operating with a very, very regular bimetallic currency between silver and gold as early as the reign of Athelbert. The shatters-shillings relationship in the Athelbert law codes make perfect sense as shatters are silver units, shillings are gold. The conversion rate is explained by laws in the Theodosian code of the 430s. I think it is just everything fits like that. So the conditions were certainly there in England for moving to a silver currency. It just needed somebody to have the bright idea. Hang on, we can have these coins in silver and those are going to be a lot more useful to us.
Did you have another? No.
So I'm interested in what's not on that map that you showed in the Western Britain there's plenty of Germanic incursion, enough so that in Cornwall people are leaving, that made an impact. What's the reason that you're not finding that they're left out of the equation? There's no furnished burials?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't there be furnished burials if these are the same Germanic?
Well, the first thing is it gives me the opportunity to use something that a piece of wisdom that I always give my students, which is as archaeologists, it's not our business to try and explain what people didn't do in the past. We there's a lot of things they didn't do. We focus on what they did do. So, and there's a serious point of that. In a sense, you need the motivation and the context for having furnished burials rather than sort of needing the motivation for the non-furnished burials. There were different burial traditions, and no doubt about that. Furnished burial had gone out of practice in the Roman Empire by the 4th century to a very large degree. There are variants. There are always variants in these things, and those traditions, although evolving, continued the same in that basis in those areas of the West where we can find burials. In fact, radiocarbon dating is now enabling us to identify more so-called early Christian, it tends to be referred to as the early Christian period in the West rather than early medieval, more of those burials there as well. We do in fact see to some degree an expansion as we're going into the 7th century of the zone of furnished Anglo-Saxon burial into the West. But it's not going very far, and it's certainly not going as far as we know the political conquest was going. So by the 7th century, we've actually got quite a large number of cemeteries in Dorset, as opposed to the one or two that we've got from the 6th century. We're picking up sites in Somerset then. We're picking up sites in the Peak District of Derbyshire as well. So there's a little bit of an expansion. But if you like, it's almost an expansion against the tide. It's against a tide of furnished burial becoming more and more exclusive in the what are now the core Anglo-Saxon lands. It's becoming considerably more something that is practiced at a smaller number of sites. I don't really want to go to the point of saying it's always elite, because I think it's a very, very local elite who may be practicing furnished burial still, rather than anything that we can call a full regional aristocracy. So this fundamentally, this just isn't a practice that gets in there and gets adopted by the populations there. I certainly wouldn't read anything from it in terms of the relative numbers of new properly Anglo-Saxon, if you like, settlers moving westwards in Essex, in Wessex, as Wessex expands. Okay. I mean, within the material culture suite that we get in these later graves, we do in fact have some very interesting items that in themselves we would describe as being of British and British meaning Western. Celtic is the broad term that you use for it. It's a very problematic term, I'm afraid, or Irish or Scottish origin, so that, for instance, the very famous hanging bowls with their Litane ornament, their use of enamel, and so on. This is clearly something that the techniques and the form are coming from the West and the North and being adopted in English culture too. There is exchange. There is overlap, there's evidence of it before, there's absolutely no question about that. But in this case, we are talking about something that we can call the Anglo-Saxon culture, a core feature of Anglo-Saxon culture, and it's sitting there in the early conquered, colonized, acculturated territories and not spreading very much beyond those. It is a bit, but not very much.
That's all right. This is a question okay. That summarizes. I mean, I can right. Dance now in history here. I asked this from simple ignorance because I was struck, really struck by the calibration curve.
Yes.
You showed. You might want to.
Yeah.
Bring it back up again.
Sure.
I just had thought about the problem of what happens when the ratios of two isotopes do uptick. I just wanted to know what are the factors that are driving this, in this case, this really dramatic reversal.
These variations. Right. Okay. You in for a nice long physics lesson, or do you want the short summary of it? It all starts with sunspot activity. Okay. And that creates cosmic radiation. Okay. And with bursts, flares of sunspot activity, you get a lot more sort of stray particles coming into the atmosphere. And that changes the quantities of the radioactive carbon that there are in the atmosphere.
So does this mean that we find moments of this regular intervals because of sunspot activity?
Yeah, I mean, that is fundamentally it. Now, there's a couple of points to make about this. How do we create, how do we know how it changed in the past? You do this through measuring, you've got known age wood. Through tree rings, you can create sequences of real known age going back thousands of years. And to create the tradition, this isn't the radiocarbon dating curve that we had when we started. Every 6-7 years or so, there's a new international calibration standard is issued, and it's refined gradually. And you can then, in fact, you can just take your radiocarbon ages and all of your results before, you can recalibrate. And you'd expect a little bit of wobble. They might become a little bit more, more refined. But, these things are changing. They are, again, mathematical and scientific models, rather than, cut in stone facts for the whole thing. Now, traditionally, it was done by taking 20-year chunks of tree rings and then averaging the score that you got for that 20-year period. For our project, we redid the curve between AD 390 and I think it was AD 810 on a decadal basis, taking 10-year chunks, and got a much finer line. But you're still going to be basically taking a finer line through this. And if you've got a point where it turns back on itself, you're never, ever going to get rid of that problem. So I would basically say that for the 5th century, which is what this is largely covering, high-precision radiocarbon dating is never going to do it. I could have a radiocarbon date that was plus or minus zero in terms of its probability range, and it would still give me a calibrated result rather like that, because it's still got to spread out that probability according to what the calibration curve tells it to do. I'm told that there's some labs there that are now going down to a single year basis for calibration. You know, so in some cases, I mean, I won't go into all the modelling maths of all of this, but being able to show in RAF Lake and Heath that in some cases a real high precision date is critical. It makes a difference. There are other cases where you might just as well go to standard precision, because it's not going to make any difference in your models. You might as well save the extra 50 quid that you're spending on that high precision date and spend it on something, you know, or you know, save that on a few dates and get an extra date in somewhere. You know, that but this is, you can simulate results. You know, you can do your modeling in advance with possible results that you might get and use that as a basis for deciding how to sample. Okay? Yeah. Is this a global curve? There are some differences between northern and southern hemisphere, but fundamentally it's global. Yeah.
Yeah. Mike McCormick here. I just want to emphasize how important this talk is from the point of view of insisting on using radiocarbon dating. When we speak with scientists, they always ask, well, when we talk about dating manuscripts, why don't you radiocarbon date the parchment? And we explain that we can date it just as well with scripts and so forth. I'm not sure that we can always do that, but it's important for all of us here to realize that archaeologists tend not to use radiocarbon dating in the periods that I work in. The argument is we have coins. We have highly refined typologies of objects, and of course, as though coins did not continue to be used long after they were issued, and that they provide us only with a terminus post quem. So the fundamental step here of insisting that we need to use radiocarbon, we need to use it at the highest level of precision and quality possible, is really, really important for us to absorb and to carry forward. It's a little bit more expensive, but the results are really fantastic, John.
One can also add to this, I mean, there are side products to this with the, when you're measuring the carbon isotopes, even if you're only doing it for the purposes of radiocarbon dating, you're actually producing dietary data as well. There's one of the carbon isotopes varies according to the amount of terrestrial meat or marine meat that is in your diet. There've been lots and lots of side products of this that are genuinely fascinating. So.
Grateful for that. Okay. Let's thank our speaker.
Well, thank you very much for having me.